Alrighty, what's going on, everybody, and welcome to the first installment of Doc and Caveman's annual NBA Draft Prospect Profiles. I'm Dr. Fantasy, and as always, here with the Fantasy Caveman. Today, we're going to be kicking it off with Chet Holmgren, a lot of people's number one prospect. 7'1", depending on what site you're reading. Freshman, 195 pounds from Gonzaga. As a freshman, averaged 14.1 points, 9.9 rebounds, 3.7 blocks. Shot 39% from three-point land. Caveman, what are your initial thoughts on him, his strengths? What do you got?
Oh, man. I don't know if there has been a more tantalizing prospect in recent memory. There's just so much to like about him. I'm gonna start with something that you appreciate about him. His just defensive impact. You see a lot of guys with this type of size, not really know how to use their size, if that makes sense. And he knows how to use his size to alter shot. You just had the average 3.7 blocks a game, which was fourth in the nation. And then if you try to, you would think with his size, oh, I'll be able to just pick on him in isolation because he's slow or whatever. And that wasn't really the case either, because opponents shot just 31% versus him in isolation. So, I mean, there's just so much to like about him. I saw a couple of highlights. I saw he has that Dirk fadeaway down pat. Like, I'm sorry, that looks so much like Dirk when he does that. Like, he has that down pat. Just something else I noticed. What about you? I'm sure there's just where to start. There's so many things to love about this guy.
Yeah, I mean, he really is the modern kind of big man that the league is trending towards. I mean, 39% from three isn't anything to sneeze at, even for a guard. So to be that tall and that lanky, and you know, his wingspan touches around 7'3", based on what I've seen. Once again, kind of depends on who you're asking. I don't know what tape measure they're using, but apparently it's not the same one. But yeah, I mean, he shoots really well for his size. You'll see that he's pretty smooth from three-point land. And I think the really interesting piece of that is he can create his own three-point shot. It's not like all of that is just off of passes from his teammates. I think that's impressive. I mean, there's times where he's gotten rebounds, he's leading transition, and he'll just pull up and shoot a three. I mean, how often do you see that from a seven-foot guy?
And like you mentioned with his ability to create, he has a very great handle for his size. He's not sloppy when he's dribbling the ball. He's not sloppy with the ball at all. He really knows how to, for him being that size and for him to be able to create his own shot like he's able to do, you don't see many guys this tall really come out in general. But especially when you got big men that can just handle the ball. You just don't see that coming out, right? At least right away. You just don't see guys coming out like him and being able to handle the ball as well as he does.
Yeah, no, definitely not. And that's the thing that makes him unique. And I mean, we'll talk about it when we get to comparisons. But I mean, I know there's a few names that float around there that people really like. But I do think he's one of those really unique prospects that, you know, he's kind of his own player, and he's, you know, there's not a perfect comparison for him, you know, between the ball handling. You know, there's shades of, we see big guys like Anthony Davis and Bam do that, but pieces of their offensive game aren't like Chet. So, you know, he's got a lot of pieces of a lot of the great big men in the league right now. So I'm interested to see what he does. And, you know, we haven't talked much too. You mentioned, I guess, a little bit, but just his defense is, you know, 3.7 blocks a game. That's nothing to sneeze at. And, you know, it's surprising to me a little bit because obviously, which this transitions to the weaknesses, you would think that he would struggle defending in the paint a little more than he does because of his size, but he holds pretty true. And as much as it's going to be a struggle for him at the next level, and he's definitely going to have to bulk up to deal with some of the bigger guys, I don't think that he was embarrassingly bad in the paint. He was average, which I think is at least something to work with.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned, you talked, I mean, the thing everybody's picks on with him is that he's very slight and very scary. Like you said, he's only 100, he's not even 200 pounds. And crazy. When we get to talk another guy, you mentioned a guy who we will cover later in Jaden Ivey. He's 6'4 and weighs the same amount as Chet. This is just, that's just, I mean, that's, it's just crazy. It's just crazy to think about that. And the other thing I really noticed is that while he did average 9.9 rebounds a game, I would have liked to see him, I don't know if it's a little bit more aggressive on the defensive glass or if he just sometimes his brain caught up to him. But I think you saw against some of the bigger dudes in college, he kind of struggled to get the rebound. He's very vulnerable to, like, if somebody puts like a spin move on him or just tries to back him down a little bit, he does struggle sometimes with that stuff, which, I mean, this, he can put on weight, and I'm sure day one, you know, he's going to be eating protein bars and whatever.
Protein bars aren't enough. He needs to just be eating like whole pigs.
He just needs to like just go to McDonald's for 3 meals a day for a while or something. I don't know, but that's going to be something day one they're going to focus on. And I'm not that concerned about it, to be honest, because he'll put on the strength. But if he doesn't, the thing is with him is if he tries to stay at this weight in the NBA, he's going to get abused, and it's not going to be that pretty. He did hold his own in college, but we all know the NBA is a much bigger and better animal than college. So I think even he's aware that he's gonna add some stuff to his frame. Did you have anything else you wanted to point out before we move on to some team fits and comparisons?
Yeah, just a few quick things. His playmaking isn't fantastic as much as he's a great ball handler for his size. He doesn't, you know, and it's not necessarily going to be his role in the NBA, but it's definitely not one of his strengths. And the other thing, he's not great at defending on the perimeter. So if he's trying to defend some of these more modern bigs that are, you know, have three-point range and their offensive game is vast, he's going to struggle with them just because he's not super quick on his feet. Defensively anyway. So I think he's not going to be overly versatile defensively. I think we talked a little bit about his assertiveness too. So yeah,
wouldn't be fair if he was defensively versatile. That's okay. I think he can't have everything. He can't do it. Like if I saw you out there guarding two guards, he'd be the best player to ever exist.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things though. We talked about it with Evan Mobley last year. He's kind of able to do things like that, and the Cavaliers last year were very creative in using him defensively because he had a pretty small frame as well, not as small as Chet. Chet's taller and like 20 pounds lighter still, but even the Cavs were able to use him defensively to where he wasn't put in positions where he could be abused by bigger offensive players. So I think whatever team Chet goes to is going to have to use him, especially early in his career, in a strategic way on the defensive end, because there's no doubt about his offensive upside and what he can contribute from day one. But defensively, I think there's going to be some bumps in the road just because of his size, and teams are going to try to pick that apart. So it's going to take a good coach to strategically use him defensively. So let's move over. I guess that's a good transition too to some ideal fits. So, what do you have for that, Caveman?
I have To be honest, I just have one, and that's the Pistons. We didn't talk about it too much, but I think his pick and roll potential, especially with Cade being able to set him up. I mean, that you talk about a Chet and Cade duo. That's something. That's something to drool over, really, if you think about it.
Who goes to the bench in that case? Who's coming off the bench between him, Stewart, and Grant? Is that Isaiah Stewart then?
Probably. I mean, even if you have the depth at he's a five, but it's like it's almost like as if he's so unique, you have to invent a new position for him. I don't know, but I think, yeah, I mean, not, I just like the potential with him and Cade. I mean, that, the picket, so, what do you have down?
I think the number one is probably the Thunder. I mean, they probably, as always, maybe eventually this will change, but it still feels like they need almost every position. I guess they look pretty solid with Shai and Josh Giddey, but,
their backcourt's okay.
Yeah, I think they'll be fine there. But, I mean, I still think he'd be a nice fit there. I think when they took Pukusevski, this is kind of what they were looking for. And he's still young, and he hasn't quite lived up to some of the potential that some people thought he would have. So it's not that I'm giving up on him, but Chet is what they wanted him to be right now. So they don't have to worry about him developing. So... yeah, I think that's if the Thunder have the number one overall pick, I think this is going to be the pick. You know, and the number one overall pick, I think it's really dependent on who has it this year, you know, because you could kind of interchange quite a few of these top guys that we're going to be talking about. But I think the fit with the Thunder is kind of exactly what they're looking for. They're They were actually not terrible defensively, but I think that this would really, he'd be able to be a defensive anchor for them in the future too. So yeah. I personally think the Thunder are probably where you're looking. I see a lot of people, Orlando too, if they're in that position, but I don't love that fit personally, but Wendell Carter was finally seemed to kind of put it together last year. So I'm not as high on that fit, but yeah, I have the Thunder as my number one. But realistically, he is so versatile. You could kind of throw him in anywhere, even Houston, who's going to be in contention for the number one overall pick. They had Sengun and Christian Wood, but they weren't really playing on the court at the same time. So you could kind of rotate those three guys around.
Yeah. Yeah. He could fit anywhere, but if I'm looking at the top teams, like, yeah, like I said, Houston would probably be my least favorite destination for him. I don't really, but because they're paying Christian Wood's making a lot of money.
Yes.
And he is, at least, especially on the defensive end, he is atrocious on the defensive end of the court, Christian Wood. I would trust Sengun to come in right away and be that defensive anchor in the front court, which is what Houston really needs. So, yeah. But, like, he'd fit anywhere. He's one of those, and we talk, he's the most tantalizing prospect that's come out in a long time. He can truly go anywhere, to be honest.
Yep. I would agree. All right. What do you got for comparisons? I know you have one.
You already mentioned him. I have a couple down, but the one you mentioned, I mean, the shades of Evan Mobley are there. Like you said, Evan Mobley is a bit heavy, a little bit different frame, but I think they bring a lot of similar elements. Maybe it's just because of the fadeaway, but I'm throwing Dirk out there. Maybe it's just because of the fadeaway he does perfect. But I think he has the ability, just like Dirk was a really good 3-point shooter, pretty much his entire career. And I think day one that's something Chet has in his game. And then he's going to be a 7-footer that can really become an excellent shooter. Dirk wasn't I don't know what Dirk was listed as, but Dirk wasn't was on the relatively skinnier side for being 7 foot. I forgot what he was officially, but he has similar like frame, 3-point ability, that fadeaway. So I see a lot of elements of Dirk in him too.
Yeah, Dirk ended his playing career at 240, but I would beg to differ that's what he started.
There's no way
he
was 240. I don't know. Did he really end it? Did he just let himself go at the end of his career?
Yeah, he just started. Hey, you said that he needed to eat cheeseburgers every day. So Dirk was
what
just.
Dirk did.
But yeah, no, I mean, I think people lose their minds when you throw out comparisons like Dirk. And to me, I don't think it makes sense to lose your mind over that just because. You know, when Dirk first came out, did anyone really think that he was going to become the legend that he was? I mean, absolutely not. So I don't think things like that are crazy at all. I mean, he has more defensive ability than Dirk, so he's already got that going for him. Dirk was never that kind of shot blocker and was never really considered an elite defensive piece. So, you know, he has that kind of... I mean, imagine that, though. He does have the offensive upside of Dirk. He does. That's just the reality with his size, his length, his shooting ability. I mean, he has that ability. Imagine Dirk as an elite defender. And he could be that. That's his upside, realistically. And, yeah, I had Evan Mobley down as well. I think you messaged me Porzingis the one day.
Yeah,
I think Porzingis is a really fair comparison.
It's fair. I hope for Chet's sake. I think that was a good decent amount to do with his frame because they're kind of built similarly, which is part of the reason why I see it. But we've seen Porzingis, you know, partly due to his height and the way he's built, have a lot of injury concerns throughout this point in his career. And I just think the way that they're built, I just hope that. That doesn't happen for Chet because those guys, his frame they do tend to become more susceptible to injuries.
Yeah. Besides that, though, I mean, when you look at their games, people want to point to Porzingis' injury history, which is fair. But when he's healthy, I mean, he is an all-star caliber player that people have considered. You know, the Mavericks were trying to build a team around him and Luka, it didn't work out for him, but I mean, he's a guy that's averaged 2 3-pointers a game throughout his career. He's an elite shot blocker. He's averaged almost 19 points, so he's been no slouch. So, you know, if Chet's able to stay healthy, you know, I think a healthy Porzingis is not necessarily a bad thing. You know, I see people go, oh gosh, you don't want to take Porzingis, but I don't think there's a team in the league that wouldn't take Porzingis if he was fully healthy and you could rely on him. So I think Porzingis is a pretty good one. I had Mobley, Dirk. I mentioned Pukusevski. That's just, I think I actually am a big fan of his if he ever hit that upside, but they are actually pretty similar. Just Chet's much, much more polished. So, yeah, and like I said, it was hard because then, you know, I start thinking of versatile guys like Sabonis, but Sabonis is a little more of a playmaker. So that's why
I think
it's hard
for
me.
Sabonis has zero defense. Is Sabonis.
Yeah.
Zero defensive ability whatsoever. But that's what makes you. He has the offensive skill set of a lot of top end offensive bigs. But what makes him, like I said, what makes him unique is he has the ability defensively, and he's shown it. I mean, averaging almost 4 blocks. He has the ability defensively to just catapult himself into a whole new tier.
Yeah. Okay, I don't think I have anything else on old Chet here, so I think we'll wrap that up. Next is going to be one of your boys, I believe.
Yes.
Jabari Smith
yes.
will be next. So make sure you tune in for that, and we'll see you guys next time.
Yep.